morning, everyone. Welcome and thank you for coming to this forum today. Hope you guys feel great. It is my pleasure to see all of you right now. So, our topic for today is accounts, reports, and auditors. Before we start our forum, let me introduce myself. My name is Nazila Akasha, as your moderator for today's forum. Here, there are four special guests as our panels for today. First panel is Miss Anissa, which is sit next to me. Hi Miss, how are you feeling today?
Hi, I'm fine, thank you.
It's good. And our second panel is Miss Faizin. Hello Miss, how are you feeling today?
Hi, I'm good.
And our third panel is Miss Jenny Teo. Hello Miss, how are you feeling today?
I feel a little bit excited for during this forum.
Wow, that's good guys, she is very excited. And our last panel is Miss Nazira Munawara. Hello Miss, Assalamualaikum, how are you feeling today?
Waalaikumsalam.
Okay, that's good. So, let's start our forum for today. As we know that in Malaysia, there are two ways on appointment of an auditor, which are appointment by board of directors and appointment by annual general meeting. So my first question to Miss Anissa, can you explain more about appointment of an auditor by board of directors?
Thank you to the moderator, Miss Nazila. Today, I would like to share with you how to appoint an auditor by board of directors. Before that, an auditor must be an approved company auditor and also must be registered with FIA, which is Malaysia Institute of Accounts under Accountant Act 1967. The main important, an auditor must be independent of the company.
I agree with that because an auditor must be an independent person.
So back to the question. Every company must appoint an auditor for the main purpose of auditing its account and reporting to the members of the company. The directors of a company may appoint a person or a person to be the auditor or auditors of the company at any time before the first annual general meeting. On the other hand, if the directors did not appoint the auditor to the company can appoint the auditor in general meeting. Then, after the auditors have been appointed, the auditors of the company may hold office until the conclusion of the first annual general meeting, which means the auditor may audit the company until next AGM, which is annual general meeting. And the auditor cannot be an auditor to the company exceed 2 years.
Oh, I see. Now we all know how auditors appoint by board of directors. Next, Ms. Nazira will explain about appointment of an auditor by annual general meeting.
Thank you to our moderators. For information, the first auditor of a company would easily be appointed by the directors, or alternatively, the shareholders will appoint the auditor during first annual general meeting. In practice, the directors of a public company choose the auditor whose appointment is the approved or rejected by members at the next annual general meeting after the appointment. When the public company is formed, its director appoints an auditor who holds office until the conclusion of the first annual general meeting. The shareholders then appoint the auditor at the annual general meeting. The auditor holds office until they retire or cease to hold office in accordance with the company's act. A returning auditor shall be reappointed without any resolution being passed unless he is not qualified for reappointment. A resolution has been passed at the meeting appointing somebody instead of him or providing expressly that he shall not be reappointed. And last, he has given given the company notice in writing of his unwillingness to be reappointed. If a vacancy occurs, the directors appoint a replacement who hold office until the next annual general meeting, when the appointment is put to shareholders.
Thank you, Ms. Nazira. Thank you, Ms. Anissa. I hope you guys clear about the appointment of an auditor in Malaysia, which are by board of directors and by annual general meeting. So the next is, an auditor may be removed during his term of office by an ordinary resolution of the company at the general meeting. It is necessary to accommodate the case where an existing auditor has become obviously unsuitable to continue in office. So, Ms. Jenny will explain more to us about the rights of an auditor in the event of dismissal.
Thank you to the moderator. The right of auditor during removal of auditor, according to the section 277 Company Act 2016, a company, upon receiving the special notice of intention to remove auditor from office, should be immediately send a copy of the notice to the auditor purpose and to the registrar. Next, upon receiving the special notice, the auditor concerned may be within 7 days from the receipt of the notice make a representation in writing to the company and request that a copy of the representation to be circulated by the company to every member to whom the notice of the meeting is sent. The auditor then should submit a copy of the written representation to the register within 7 days from the submission date. Last, after passing of the resolution to remove auditor from office under section 276 Company Act 2016, the company should give a notice of the fact to the registrar within 14 days in accordance with section 278 Clause 1 Company Act 2016.
Thank you, Ms. Jenny, for that answer. So I hope you guys know about the rights of an auditor in the event of dismissal, especially for auditors out there. I hope you guys take note. And the last part is, there are three types of account, which the first one is profit and loss. Profit and loss account is one of the financial statements of a company and shows the company's revenue and expenses during a particular period. So, Ms. Faizin will explain about the profit and loss account.
Profit and loss account provides a summary of a company's net asset over a given period of time. In other words, the statement highlights the adjustment on equity during a given time frame. The aim of preparing the income statement is to find the company's net income. Profit and loss account, as advised by the Act, include an income and expenditure account, revenue account, or any other account showing the result of the business of a corporation for a period.
Move to the next account, which is balance sheet account. Balance sheet is a statement of the asset, liabilities and capital of a business or other organization at a particular point in time, detailing the balance of income and expenditure over the preceding period. And Ms. Faizin will explain more about balance sheet.
Balance sheet consists of the following key elements, which is the first one, asset, something that the entity owns. Secondly, liabilities, is the obligation that the business owes to someone. And third one is the equities, what business owes to its owners. The balance sheet lists the resources, obligation and ownership details of a company on a specific company. This data will help you to track your company's performance and will identify ways in which you can look up your finance and see where you need to improve. Balance sheet also provide information about the results of your operation and to make decision making regarding the allocation of resources.
So the last account, which is consolidated account. Consolidated account is the process of combining the financial result of several subsidiary companies into the combined financial result of the parent company. So, Ms. Faizin will explain more about consolidated account.
This consolidated account is typically used when a parent entity owns more than 50% of the shares of another entity. If a subsidiary uses a different currency as its operating currency, an additional consolidation account step is to convert its financial statements into the operating currency of the parent company. A consolidated profit and loss account and a consolidated balance sheet of a holding company and its subsidiary companies must be made out. The main purpose of preparing this account is to ensure that members of and for the matter persons dealing with a holding company are provided with full information as to the profit and loss and the state of affairs of that company and its subsidiaries within the group.
So, this has come to the end of our forum for today. I would like to say thank you to our panels for joining us for this forum. And let me recap everything that we have discussed for today's forums. The first one, we already explained about the appointment of an auditor in Malaysia. We already explained the rights of an auditor in the event of dismissal. And we already discussed the profit and loss account, balance sheet account, and consolidated account. I hope you guys can get knowledge for this forum. And I would like to say thank you for everyone for coming to this forum. Thank you.